Good evening. Glad y'all came to worship with us tonight. Before we get started, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have to celebrate the giving of your Son. Father, we thank you that you came as a child to bear our iniquities and our sins in order that we might have forgiveness of sin. Father, we thank you for those who are going to use their gifts and their talents to praise and worship you tonight. I pray that all that is said and all that is done will bring honor and glory to you. May Jesus be lifted up, and it's in his holy name we pray. Amen. Now, if I make some mistakes tonight, y'all understand, you've seen that I'm making the order of service out as we go, and I'm writing it down. A guy with Parkinson's doesn't write too good, so I may misinterpret what I've written. But we want to have a congregational song to start with, Titus. Did I call you the right name? Did I call you?
If you want to move, you can do it. And I'll say this too before we get started. A lot of people are wanting to play and sing, so if you hear a song, you might hear it twice. If you do, it'll just be different. So thought I'd throw that out there, because I think I know of at least one. So if you would stand, let's sing It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. You don't have to go into that. Sounds good to me. I will have to say I love the fact that we can all sit here in a church building where even on a Sunday morning when a baby cries like that, nobody cares.
That's a cool thing, because as y'all remember, on a Sunday morning, most times anymore, half the congregation leaves when they say, well, the children go to children's church. So if that's all we're known for, that's a good thing to be known for. Known that I brought both of them. Stand if you would, listening. Oh, come, all you faithful.
God has always wanted his people to be a people of hope. He was planting the seed of hope in the Garden of Eden when he told Adam and Eve, said, the seed of the woman will produce somebody that will bruise the head of the serpent. It was the hope of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, who was given 4,000 years before he finally arrived. In Isaiah, several hundred years before Christ rise, he says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulders, and he shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. We're so grateful tonight that Jesus Christ came. He has provided the hope that all of us have of eternity in heaven with God one day. But he also gives us hope for tomorrow, knowing that we have his promise of his watch care over us and the power to overcome sin and the enemy of our life. With that, Leanne, would you come and read? I pronounce her name Leanne because I'm from Texas, but actually it's pronounced Leanna. Forgive me.
Luke chapter 2. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus and that all the world should be registered. This census took first place when Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, into the city of David, which is now called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was his child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, whose Christ is the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find him wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." Then suddenly there was an angel in the multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God, saying, "Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to men." So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds had said no to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us."
Wendy, would you and Margaret?
This song is not a traditional Christmas song, but 2020 has been a really hard year for a lot of people. And even when it's not been a hard year, sometimes the holidays is difficult for people when you've lost someone, and or just lots of reasons. And this song is called "Somewhere in Your Silent Night," and it just talks about how you just have to look up to Jesus, and He's your Savior. He's always there, and he's going to help you through it. So I hope you enjoy it.
Somewhere is calm. Too far out of reach. Somewhere in your silent night, heaven hears a song. Your broken heart is crying. Hope is here, just lift your head, for love has come.
You want me to get Lex?
For years, Miss Joyce Jackson always had something that she read, and it always resulted in her crying, and it made about half the congregation cry with her. But in memory of her and what she meant to this church and to all of us for so long, Carla's kind of promised to pick up the pieces. I think she's got something to read tonight.
I hope I don't cry. After Wendy's song, though, and what's going on in my world, it's like, you shouldn't have followed that. Okay, y'all bear with me as I share a little inspirational story that, as I said, Christmas Eve was really, really important to Miss Joyce and to Mama, and neither of them are here right now, but life goes on, and that's what they would want us to do. It felt different walking into church tonight without Mama, But I think y'all all know what this church meant to her. Okay. Paul never had much compassion for the lazy or those who squandered their means and then never had enough for the necessities. But for those who were genuinely in need, his heart was as big as all outdoors. It was from him that I learned the greatest joy in life comes from giving, not from receiving. It was Christmas Eve, 1881. I was 15 years old and feeling like the world had caved in on me because there just hadn't been enough money to buy me the rifle that I'd wanted for Christmas. We did the chores early that night for some reason. I just figured Paul wanted a little extra time so we could read the Bible. After supper was over, I took off my boots and stretched out in front of the fireplace and waited for Paul to get down the old Bible. I was still feeling sorry for myself, and to be honest, I really wasn't in much of a mood to read scriptures. But Paul didn't get out the Bible. Instead, he bundled up again and went outside. I couldn't figure it out because we'd already done all the chores. I didn't worry about it long, though. I was too busy wallowing in my own self-pity. Soon, Paul came back in. It was a cold, clear night out, and there was ice in his beard. "Come on, Matt," he said. "Bundle up good. It's cold out tonight." I was really upset then. Not only was I not getting the rifle for Christmas, now Paul was dragging me out in the cold, and for no earthly reason that I could foresee. We'd already done all the chores, and I couldn't think of anything else that needed doing, especially not on a night like this. But I knew Paul was not very patient at one dragging one's feet when he had told them to do something. So I got up, put my boots back on, got my cap, coat, and mittens. Ma gave me a mysterious smile as I opened the door to leave the house. Something was up, but I didn't know what. Outside, I became even more dismayed. There in front of the house was the work team, already hitched to the big sled. Whatever it was we're going to do wasn't going to be a short, quick little job. I could tell that. We never hitched up this sled unless we were going to haul a big load. Paul was already up on the seat, reins in hand. I reluctantly climbed up beside him. The cold was already biting at me. I wasn't happy. When I was on, Paul pulled the sled around the house and stopped in front of the woodshed. He got off, and I followed. "I think tonight we'll need to put on the high side boards," he said. "Here, help me." The high side boards? It had been a bigger job than I wanted to do with just the low side boards on. But whatever it was we were going to do would be a lot bigger with the high sideboards on. After we had exchanged the sideboards, Paul went into the woodshed and came out with an armload of wood, the wood that I'd spent all summer hauling down from the mountain, and then all fall sawing into blocks and splitting. What was he doing? Finally, I said something. "Paul," I asked, "what are you doing?" "You been by the Widow Jensen's lately?" he asked. The Widow Jensen lived about 2 miles down the road. Her husband had died a year or so before and left her with 3 children, the oldest being 8. "Sure, I've been by, but so what?" "Yeah," I said. "Why?" "I rode by just today," Paul said. "Little Jakey was out digging around in the wood pile trying to find a few chips. They're out of wood, Matt." That was all he said. Then he turned and went back into the woodshed for another armload of wood. I followed him. We loaded the sled so high that I began to wonder if the horses would be able to pull it. Finally, Paul called a halt to our loading. Then we went to the smokehouse, and Paul took down a big ham and a side of bacon. He handed them to me and told me to put them in the sled and wait. When he returned, he was carrying a sack of flour over his right shoulder and a smaller sack of something in his left hand. "What's in that little sack?" I asked. "Shoes. They're out of shoes. Little Jakey just had gunny sacks wrapped around his feet when he was out in the wood pile this morning. I got the children a little candy, too. It just wouldn't be Christmas without a little candy." We rode the 2 miles to Widow Jensen's pretty much in silence. I tried to think through what Paul was doing. We didn't have much by worldly standards. But, of course, we did have a big wood pile, though most of what was left now was still in the form of logs that I would have to saw into blocks and split before we could use it. We also had meat and flour, so we could spare that. But I knew we didn't have any money, so why was Paul buying them shoes and candy? Really, why was he doing any of this? Widda Jensen had closer neighbors than us. It shouldn't be our problem. We came in from the blind side of the Jensen's house and unloaded the wood as quietly as possible. Then we took the meat and flour and shoes to the door. We knocked. The door cracked a small bit, and a timid voice said, "Who is it?" "Lucas Miles, ma'am, and my son Matt. Could we come in for a bit?" Widda Jensen opened the door and let us in. She had a blanket wrapped around her shoulders. The children were wrapped in another and were sitting in front of the fireplace by a very small fire that hardly gave off any heat at all. Widda Jensen fumbled with a match and finally lit the lamp. "We brought you a few things, ma'am," Pa said and set down the sack of flour. I put the meat on the table. Then Pa handed her the sack that had the shoes in it. She opened it hesitantly and took the shoes out one pair at a time. There was a pair for her and one for each of the children. Sturdy shoes, the best shoes that would last. I watched her carefully. She bit her lower lip to keep it from trembling, and then tears filled her eyes and started running down her cheeks. She looked up at Pa like she wanted to say something, but it just wouldn't come out. "We brought a load of wood too, ma'am," Pa said. He turned to me and said, "Matt, go bring in enough to last a while. Let's get that fire up to size and heat this place up." I wasn't the same person when I went back out to bring in the wood. I had a big lump in my throat, and as much as I hate to admit it, there were tears in my eyes too. In my mind, I kept seeing those three kids huddled around that fireplace, around that blanket, and their mother standing there with tears running down her cheek with so much gratitude in her heart that she couldn't speak. My heart swelled within me, and a joy that I'd never known before filled my soul. I had given at Christmas many times before, but never when it had made so much difference. I could see we were literally saving the lives of these people. I soon had the fire blazing and everyone's spirits soared. The kids started giggling when Pa handed them each a piece of candy, and Widow Jensen looked on with a smile that probably hadn't crossed her face for a long time. She finally turned to us. "God bless you," she said. "I know the Lord has sent you. The children and I have been praying that he would send one of his angels to spare us." In spite of myself, the lump returned to my throat and the tears welled up in my eyes again. I'd never thought of Pa in those exact terms before, but after Widow Jensen mentioned it, I could see that it was probably true. I was sure that a better man than Pa had never walked the earth. I started remembering all the times he'd gone out of his way for Ma and me and many others. The list seemed endless as I thought on it. Pa insisted that everyone try on the shoes before we left. I was amazed when they all fit, and I wondered how he had known what sizes to get. Then I guessed that if he was on an errand for the Lord would make sure that he got the right sizes. Tears were running down Widow Jensen's face again when we stood up to leave. Pa took each of the kids in his big old arms and gave them a hug. They clung to him and didn't want us to go. I could see that they missed their Pa, and I was glad that I still had mine. At the door, Pa turned to Widow Jensen and said, "The Misses wanted me to invite you and the children over for Christmas dinner tomorrow. The turkey will be more than the three of us can eat, and a man can get quite cantankerous if he has to eat turkey for too many meals. We'll be by to get you about 11. It'll be nice to have some little ones around again. Matt here hasn't been little for quite a spell. I was the youngest. My two brothers and two sisters had all married and moved away." Widow Jensen nodded and said, "Thank you, Brother Miles. I don't have to say may the Lord bless you, because I know for certain that he will." Out on the sled, I felt a warmth that came from deep within, and I didn't even notice the cold. When we'd gone a ways, Pa turned to me and said, "Matt, I want you to know something. Your Ma and me have been tucking a little money away here and there all year so we could buy that rifle for you, but we didn't have quite enough. Then yesterday, a man who owed me a little money from years back came to make things square. Your Ma and me were so excited, thinking that now we could get you that rifle, and I started into town this morning to do just that. But on the way, I saw little Jakey out scratching in the woodpile with his feet wrapped in those gunny sacks, and I knew what I had to do. Son, I spent the money for shoes and a little candy for those children. I hope you understand. I understood, and my eyes became wet with tears. I understood very well, and I was so glad Pa had done it. Now, the rifle seemed very low on my list of priorities. Pa had given me a lot more. He had given me the look on Widow Jensen's face and the radiant smiles of her three children. For the rest of my life, whenever I saw any of the Jensens or even split a block of wood, I remembered. And remembering brought back that same joy I felt riding home beside Pa that night. Pa had given me much more than a rifle that night. He had given me the best Christmas of my life.
I'm going to share a little poetry. I wrote it last year, and I read it last year. And I'm going to read it again this year. It's a story. It's a Christmas poem. It's I'll just start it. Come, small children, and gather around. I will tell a story of something found. Once, when I too was small, I heard a man like myself call. He said he had great things to say, news that would take over my day. At one time, he said, I worked a field, raising creatures to whose death God's anger would yield. One night in the field, watching I sat, under my hand was a lamb I was giving a pat. And suddenly I was surrounded by light. It was heaven sent, full of angel bright. Awestruck I was, and fear took me. But have no fear, said the fiery he. A savior was in David's small town. Hearing this, I fell to the ground. God above had decided to tell the people on whom misfortune had fell. Excited we were, my comrades and I. We who had always been timid and shy. But now we rushed to see the one, God's virgin, begotten, beloved son. When we neared, we spotted a woman fair and her husband trying to do his share. While in the small manger lay the one to become our everyday. Down to our knees we bowed. We praised our Lord long and loud. Finally, time to leave arrived for us, and a thought overtook us all like a gust. We decided to spread the news the same angel tongue had loosed. That is why I have called you near, to tell you news of the one who is here. So, small ones, I remind you of this, the story of one born to bring eternal bliss.
Was accused of being tall, but I will have to move it. The other day I heard Ava play, and I asked her, I said, do you think it would be a problem if everybody sang with you? And she seemed like she was up for it, so I said, well, we'll give it a whirl. Maybe next time she'll let y'all sing and I won't get to play, but we'll try it this time. Danny Wood, let's sing Away in a Manger.
Y'all can be assured I'm not going to sing. I know it. Y'all waited for that, wasn't you? I have a little reading I want to share with you, and I feel really humbled, especially after following all these young folks. Y'all are the future of our church. We're in good hands with them, I'll tell you. And y'all should have seen that smile on Tracy's face when that grandbaby got up there and started playing a while ago. You lit up bigger than any Christmas light, I can tell you. Tracy read a while ago out of Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. These will be his royal titles, Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." I hope that y'all have had a chance to look up at those two planets over the last few evenings. So close together. My wife and I went out there the other night and looked. I got the binoculars out there and looked. And looking at that distance, they looked like they was just about that close to each other. Did y'all see that? Okay. And yet, that was 450 million miles apart. And then you just look out across there. Gosh, isn't God wonderful and all-knowing? There's a song in the air. There's a star in the sky. There's a mother's deep prayer and a baby's low cry. And the star rains its fire while the beautiful sing, for the manger of Bethlehem cradles a king. A number of years ago, there was a Christmas card that was titled, "If Christ Had Not Come." And I had to look it up, and I looked it up to read it. In John chapter 15, verse 22, it says, "If I had not come, then people would not have been found guilty." Okay, but since I did come and gave the word to them, they are guilty. So it took me to take care of it. But the card is about a minister falling asleep on a Christmas morning, and in his sleep he began to dream of a world into which Jesus had never came. In his dream, he saw himself walking through the house, but as he looked, he saw no stockings hung on the chimney, no Christmas tree, no wreaths of holly, and no Christ to comfort and gladden hearts or to save us. Then he walked across and out into the street, but there was no church with its spiral pointing towards heaven. Then he came back and sat down in his library, and he realized that every book about our Savior had disappeared. The minister dreamed that the doorbell rang and that a messenger asked him to visit a poor friend's dying mother. He reached her home, and as the friend sat and wept, he said, "I have something here that will comfort you." He opened his Bible to look for the familiar promise, but it ended with Malachi. There was no gospel and no promise of hope nor salvation, and all he could do was bow his head and weep with his friend and his mother in blister, cold, and despair. 2 days later, he stood beside her coffin and conducted her funeral service, but there was no message of comfort, no words of a glorious resurrection, and no thought of a mansion awaiting her in heaven. There was only dust to dust and ashes to ashes, and one long, eternal farewell. Finally, he realized that Christ had not come, and he burst into tears, weeping bitterly in his sorrowful dream. Then suddenly he awoke with a start, and a great shout of joy and praise burst from his lips as he heard his choir singing these words in a church nearby. "O come, all you faithful, joyful, and triumphant. O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Let us be glad and rejoice today, because he has come. And let us remember the proclamation of the angel. I bring you good news, a great joy, and that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." And aren't we glad that we have this time of year to celebrate that occasion.
A number of months ago, God sent a young couple to this church that made me wish that I had lived a more godly life when I was a young person. That they just, Holy Spirit just oozes forth from them. And I appreciate their attendance here and their goodwill. And I've asked Allie if she would come and play the violin tonight. She has said she would. And but I appreciate her and Josh. They had other things they were doing today and made a special attempt to be back here in time so she could participate, and I appreciate her doing that. Allie, would you come? If that doesn't melt your butter, something's the matter with your biscuit. That's Caleb, could y'all grab the candles and pass them out? We got a song?
The little ones want to come up here. Love that. Y'all come up here. You want to sit right here, babe?
No.
You don't want to sit down?
I'll
you want
stand
to sit up there?
Yeah.
Okay, you sit there. Let me give you a mic. Does this one work, Santa? Okay, y'all sit on the steps if you would. Lex is going to hold this.
Okay. Hey.
If you know this song.
You know this song.
If you know this song, then I want you let Lexi and I start it, and then in a minute I'm going to point at y'all and y'all.
It's a microphone
okay.
Now.
So here we go. All right, ready,
okay.
Lex?
Yeah.
Okay.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the tinsels and lights and the presents are nice, but the real gift is you. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the carols and lights make the holiday swell, and it's all about you. Happy birthday, Jesus. Jesus, I love you. Okay, let's all sing it together. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad
it's Christmas.
All the tinsels and lights and the presents are nice, but the real gift is you. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the carols and bells make the holiday swell, and it's all about you. Happy birthday, Jesus. Jesus,
I love you.
Very good. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye.